regard insulation, I think this is also one of the favorite topics as far as undergraduate heat transfer courses are concerned. Critical radius of insulation and what do we do with that? Insulation, essentially, we have seen, or from intuition we know, that it is used to reduce the heat transfer. So by adding more and more insulation, we have almost always thought that the temperature, I mean the heat transfer rate, is going to decrease. Therefore, how much ever you add, it is not going to matter in the overall scheme of things. But that is not the truth, because if you look at, I'll just quickly in couple of minutes draw these and go ahead. So if I take a plain wall, this is a wall of thermal conductivity K, and if I have an insulation with thermal conductivity K INS, and this is this temperature is T1 and this is T infinity here, I have Q according to Fourier's law is T1 minus T infinity divided by summation of R thermal, where R thermal is essentially L wall, L insulation. So, L wall by K A plus L insulation by K A plus 1 over H A. This 1 over H A and L wall by K A are going to be there irrespective of whether we put in this insulation or no. So, these two are constants. This quantity L insulation by K insulation A is going to increase increase in thickness. So, as L insulation increases, logically we are going to see that the overall total thermal resistance increases, and therefore, Q is going to drop. Nothing great about it, it is not a problem. Okay. And as we saw in from the morning, for a plain wall, the area associated with heat transfer is constant. Whether I take this surface or this surface or this surface, the normal area to heat transfer is the same, A. So, because for a plain wall A is constant along x direction, Q is constant as well as Q double prime or heat flux is also a constant, meaning it is invariant with respect to x. This is something which we have to understand, appreciate very clearly. In fact, students should be tested on this concept, simply because we use heat flux and heat transfer rate interchangeably in numerical problems. But for a plane wall, it does not matter whether we use heat flux or heat transfer rate, we are going to have there is no effect of the area as a function of the cross sectional or as a function of the axial location. But if I look at a radial system like a sphere or a cylinder, what is going to happen is the following. So, let us take this is a cylinder, and whatever I do for a cylinder is valid for a sphere. So, this is T1 and this is h comma t infinity and this is just a wall. Okay. A pipe which is carrying steam is going to lose heat from here to here. Okay. So, there, this is the direction of heat transfer. So, I can write Q is equal to T1 minus T infinity. Please note, I have this resistance inside for steam flow is also constant. So, I am not taking that. I am writing this temperature difference. So, I am writing the temperature difference T1 minus T infinity. So, I will have the resistances associated with conduction through the wall and convection. So, this will be log R2 by R1 by 2 pi L K wall plus 1 over H A surface. Okay. And this 1 over H A surface is what? Is nothing but 1 over h times 2 pi r 2 l. If this is r 1 and this is r 2, this is 1 over 2 pi R to L. So far, so good, no problems. Now, I am going to put an insulation material to this pipe. So, R 1, R 2 and R 3, and we have the same H comma T infinity. This surface is maintained at T 1. I can clearly say that I am going to have an additional resistance. This is a conduction resistance for the wall, this is the conduction resistance for the insulation, and this is a convective resistance for the heat flow from inside to outside. The direction of heat flow is fixed. We have an additional resistance in the path. So, I will write Q is equal to T 1 minus T infinity log R 2 by R 1 2 pi L k wall, which is also constant, plus these are the two important terms, log R 3 by R 2 2 pi L k insulation plus 1 over H A 3. These two terms have come in instead of this one term. what are these two terms? Log R 3 by R 2 divided by 2 pi L k insulation plus 1 over H 2 pi R 3 L. This is with insulation, and without insulation it is going to be 1 over H 2 pi R 2 L without insulation. Every other resistance in the problem is constant. If there is a convection on the inside of the pipe, any other material associated with the pipe wall, we do not care. Everything else is a constant. What is changed is these two quantities. So, T 1 minus T infinity divided by something plus constant value plus one term in case 1, which is equal to in second case with insulation T 1 minus T infinity constant plus term 1 plus term 2, two additional terms which are given by this. Now, I cannot say what is the effect of keeping on adding insulating material. Why? If I keep adding insulating material, this R 3 is going to increase this conduction component of the resistance, this conduction component. This is R conduction of insulation, this is R convection on the outside of the insulating surface. Surface area for a larger cylinder is larger. So, when the radius was R 2, 2 pi R 2 L, R 2 is smaller than R 3. So, this area is going to be smaller. So, the resistance here is larger, whereas here this resistance is going to become smaller because R 2 is smaller than R 3. 1 over H 2 pi R 2 L is going to be larger than 1 over H 2 pi R 3. Obviously. So, what is happening? The bottom line is, I am adding more and more insulation, the thickness is increasing, okay. Conduction resistance is increasing because this term is getting bigger and bigger, but I am going to see a drop in this quantity with additional resistance being added. And when I keep doing this adding of insulation, I will come up with a situation where I might actually see a increase in the heat transfer as opposed to a decrease in the heat transfer. So, if I plot these two resistances, this is the x axis is resistance, this is the thickness of insulation or thickness of insulation. So, or R 3 if you want to say, as R 3 increases, R convection decreases, R conduction increases, and you will come up with a summation of resistances which look something like this, and all this has been illustrated here, and most of us are familiar also. So, additional insulation increases the conduction resistance of an insulating layer, but decreases the convective resistance of the surface because of the increase in the surface area. And heat transfer of the pipe therefore may increase or decrease, and this happens because of the fact that in radial systems, though Q is equal to constant, that is sacred, we cannot change that. So, Q at any cross section is the same, how many watts is coming out from inside is what is going to go out, but heat flux is not a constant. That means, heat flux as R increases, surface area increases, heat flux progressively decreases. As R increases means A is equal to 2 pi R L or A equal to 4 pi R square, does not matter. You go outer and go to the outside surface of the cylinder progressively from the inside, the associated area for heat transfer is more, therefore, heat flux is going to be progressively decreasing. Okay, so, that is the reason for this concept. So, all this is illustrated here in case of a cylindrical pipe. This is the additional resistance which is there, and as I told you, all other resistances are constant. These are the two resistances which are going to play a role: conduction of the insulation, convective resistance on the outside of the insulation. So, if I want to optimize, if I want to have QR as optimized value, then I should have an optimal thickness of insulation, which can be obtained by differentiating this expression dQ. Basically, differentiate this one, when this is minimized, QR is going to be maximized, so on and so forth. So, all of us have done this mathematically, where the independent variable is now going to be R2. So, d by dR2 of this denominator expression, differentiate, set it equal to 0, you will get critical radius of insulation of cylinder is k over h, and for a sphere it will come to k over h. What it tells me, bottom line, is the rate of heat transfer from the cylinder increases with the addition of insulation, until where? Until the point where you reach critical radius of insulation. So, from a bare cylinder, you add a little bit of insulation, the heat transfer is going to increase as long as the value of the outer radius is smaller than the critical radius calculated this way. It reaches a maximum when R2 equal to R critical, starts to decrease beyond that point. That thus, insulating a pipe may actually increase the heat transfer rate instead of decreasing when R2 is smaller than R critical. I told you here, if you go back to this graph on the whiteboard, this is the summation of the resistances here, R total. So, as the resistance progressively, summation of the resistance progressively decreases, your heat transfer rate is going to increase. In fact, that is what is plotted there, the reciprocal is what is plotted. The heat transfer rate increases between the bare surface to the location of R equal to R critical, and then you see a drop in the heat transfer rate. So, this is something which all of us know, critical radius of insulation, people derive, ask questions on that. But we need to keep in mind that this portion involves an increase, and where do we use this? Do we need to ignore this, or do we have to be so careful in doing this? We should put insulation little beyond R critical. How much do we have to put? We have to be very careful. So, yeah, we next transparency essentially will give you a feel of how important this aspect of critical radius is. So, value of critical radius will be largest when k is large and h is small, as seen by these expressions k over h or 2 k over h here. Okay. So, lowest value of h typically we see in natural convection situation, which is about 5, order of magnitude, we are not talking of actual numbers, around 5 in gases, natural convection in gases, and common insulating material, let us say it is 0.05 watt per meter square Kelvin, we are talking of a critical radius of insulation of about 1 centimeter or 10 mm. So, if you have radiation effects, this value is going to be even smaller. So, what we are saying is, though there is a curve which is shown like this, this is the bare surface, this is the critical radius, essentially this portion is hardly 1 centimeter. So, even when we apply insulation, we are almost always beyond this portion. So, that is something which we need to appreciate. That is why in most general situations, we do not care about critical radius of insulation that much when we are doing things practically. So, in case of forced convection, this is still lesser, critical radius would be much less than 1 mm because of the larger H value associated K over H. Therefore, we can insulate hot water or steam pipes freely without worrying about the possibility of the increasing heat transfer by insulation of these pipes. So, the logic that we use for plain wall, just more the insulation merrier, is probably valid here. Electrical conducting wires where you want heat dissipation to be more, you would want it to be below the critical radius of insulation. Therefore, plastic electrical insulation may actually be used to enhance the heat transfer from electrical wire and thus keep the steady operating temperature lower and at safer levels. Okay. So, this is with regard critical radius. There is a small example problem which we will solve. This is a 3 millimeter diameter 6 meter long electric wire is tightly wrapped with a 2 millimeter thick plastic cover whose thermal conductivity K is 0.15 watt per meter Kelvin. Electrical measurements indicate that a current of 10 amperes passes through the wire, there is a voltage drop of 8 volts along the wire. So, when there is a current of 10 amperes, there is a voltage drop of 8 volts. If the insulated wire is exposed to a medium that is offering heat transfer coefficient of 12, which is typical natural convection value, and temperature is 27 degrees centigrade, determine the temperature at the interface of the wire and the plastic cover in during steady state operation. Also determine whether doubling the thickness of the plastic cover will increase or decrease this interface temperature. So, it is a straightforward problem on insulation, multiple resistances, and we have to also deal with critical radius. So, if you look at the diagram, this red portion represents the current carrying conductor whose diameter is 3 millimeter, radius 1.5 millimeter, length is 6 meters here. Then there is a plastic cover, this blue one is a plastic cover, material of thermal conductivity 0.15, this insulating material. And when you pass a current of 10 amperes, voltage drop is 8. What it means is that electrical heating kind of situation is given in terms of voltage and currents. So, power is equal to V times I, V and I are given. So, power or wattage can be obtained. This heat has to be dissipated out. Okay. So, if the insulated wire is exposed, so the heat is being carried away by a fluid which is basically air probably, which is giving a heat transfer coefficient of 12 and a temperature of the medium is 27 degrees. So, the resistance diagram here, why have we drawn only this part of the network? We have drawn this part essentially because we are dealing with the insulating plastic material, that is the blue portion, that is R plastic, and R convection represents the outside convective heat transfer resistance. For this wire, it is a heat generating problem, we cannot apply, we cannot draw a thermal resistance directly, because this is having a situation where Q is not a constant, there is a volumetric heat generation. Whatever heat is coming out, that is what is generated, that is going through this insulation and the conducting medium. Therefore, this Q what we have shown here is V times I, but that resistances associated are this plastic and the convective part. T 1 represents the temperature at the interface of the conducting wire and the plastic. And this is what we have to find. For this Q, T 1 minus T infinity is known. If I calculate these two resistances, I can apply my basic equation, which gives me the appropriate answer. But again, we follow a certain methodology. So, we have a list of assumptions that we have to write. First thing is, we have thermal conductivities which are known and constant. There is negligible contact resistance at the interface between the wire and the plastic material. There is negligible radiation, and even if there is any, all the heat transfer coefficient value takes care of it. One dimensional radial conduction. So, that is very important because we have studied only radial conduction at this point, and it is steady state environment, steady state system, because there is no change with respect to time. So, after all this we get Q is equal to 80 watts and A2, which is the area associated with this surface that we have calculated, 2 pi R to L. So, R convection can be calculated, R plastic is conduction, log R2 by R1, calculate the value, add these 2.78 degrees centigrade per watt. Therefore, the interface temperature is unknown T1, I can calculate this as 89.4 degrees centigrade. So, next part of the question was, if the thickness was doubled, what would happen? That is, yeah, also determine whether doubling the thickness of the plastic cover would increase or decrease this interface temperature. For doing that, we first have to calculate the critical radius. The critical radius comes to be 12.5 mm. This critical radius is definitely it's larger than the radius of the plastic cover. Therefore, what is the radius of the plastic cover? Radius of the plastic cover is, we have seen this here, 2 pi r to l, 0.0035, that is essentially 3 mm plus thickness which has been given to you already, 3 mm of the diameter of the wire and 2 mm plastic. So, half of it would be the radius. So, 1.5 is the radius, 2 is the thickness. So, 3.5 mm. So, 3.5 mm instead of that, if I make this thickness double, I would be adding another 2 mm. So, 4 plus 1.5, which will be 5.5 mm. So, this which is larger than the radius of the plastic cover, therefore, increasing the thickness would enhance the heat transfer until the outer radius reaches 12.5 mm. That means, we are in this part of the curve. Let me go back here. We are somewhere here. I have increased this number is 12.5. We are here at 3.5. If I make it 5.5, also we are in this part of the curve. Therefore, increasing the radius, increasing the thickness of this plastic sheet would actually increase the heat transfer in this case rather than decreasing it. So, that is something which we have to keep in mind. Okay. And as a result, the rate of heat transfer will increase when the interface temperature is held constant, or T1 will decrease when power or voltage times current, the word power is missing. T1 will decrease when power is held constant, which is the case here, V times I is held constant. Okay. So, you can calculate whatever, if the power is held constant, you can calculate the temperature, and I think it comes out to be 71.14 or 77.54, whatever. So, this is a plot which has been made to illustrate the temperature at that interface and the radius of the insulation. So, you have this plot which is essentially obtained from this equations which we have used. Okay. This summary we have already covered. Plane wall d square t by dx square, just for even though we are repeating, we do not mind doing this, simply because we have to understand, take home, as we say at the end of this, a student what he or she takes home is this finally. What is going to be asked in the exam? I think this is what most students will ask. Essentially, if we remember all this, we are in good shape and we do not have to memorize everything. Heat flux remains constant, heat transfer rate remains constant for a plane wall. Heat flux not a constant for cylinder, not a constant for spherical wall, heat transfer rate is constant irrespective of the radius for both these cases. Thermal resistance conduction L by K A, this one for cylinder, this one for sphere. Convective resistance 1 over H A. Temperature distribution, we do not have to memorize it, but point to be noted that this is a linear temperature distribution. When you have no heat generation, it is a straight line distribution, whereas this is logarithmic and this is some other functional form for spherical wall. Okay. So, we have left out one problem in the middle, which we remember, we will take it up tomorrow. From now on till about 5:30, we are open for any questions across all the institutes. Preference will be given to people who have not asked any questions so far, okay, but we will try to accommodate everybody, okay. So, SVNIT Surat, yeah, your question please.
Sir, in case of the insulation thickness, what would be the better 10 meter in case of the insulation thickness of the wall, what would be the better heat transfer case, 10 meter one wall or the each wall of the 1 meter, 10 wall of each meter?
Please rephrase your question.
Okay, sir, in the case of the insulation thickness, the thickness of the insulation, the 10 meter, and the second case is the 10 wall of 1 meter. So, which one would be the give heat based heat transfer?
Okay. The question is this, the question asked by one of the participants is that if I have an insulating material, is it good idea to take 1 meter hole as one insulation, or I will break them into 10 pieces and then add one after another? So that is the question. I think the answer is if you have 10 pieces added, will add the interfacial resistance. So that would be better, but then I don't think it is fabrication wise or putting insulation wise, putting 10 times is easier. So we usually put whatever is available in the market, we directly put. So typical thicknesses, whatever are available, we directly put them, but we cannot fragment them for 1 mm, 1 mm, 1 mm, and then put them several times. Yes, theoretically, yes. If you put several times, interfacial resistances are increasing. So definitely putting multiple layers is better than one layer, no doubt about that. But practically, I don't think it is always possible. If you are imagining a complete power plant and we have to insulate the complete power plant, one of the heat exchangers of a power plant, it's not going to be easy. Yes, in a lab scale, if you want to do something, we can definitely do that.
Gopal, yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Question is regarding energy generation, because this is the equation of energy conservation. Here, why we are writing it? Yeah, energy generation. Because there will not be any generation or consumption by a material. If there is a reaction take place, a chemical reaction, in which a generation of energy is taking place, so there supposed to be a consumption of energy also will be. That means energy generation may be a positive or negative.
Okay.
Or it will be always positive.
Okay. To rephrase his question, there is a question on energy generation. The thing is, why is there energy generation considered in the equation? I think he is saying that there will be only energy in the reaction, there will be conversion from one form to another or something like that is the question. But what we are saying is the heat diffusion or conduction equation is a very general form of equation. And mind you, chemical energy, a chemical reaction, we are not concerned with chemical energy or any other form of energy, we are concerned with heat energy only. So, this is a heat balance equation. If the reaction is not generating any heat and it is proceeding like that, H2 plus O2 is giving you two molecules of water, we are not, and if it is a non-exothermic or non-endothermic reaction, that is not going to feature in the energy budget. So, when a reaction gives out or takes in heat, energy in the form of heat, that is what we are going to take in the energy generation term. So, we are chemical reaction, nuclear reactor, all these things where thermal energy is associated, we are dealing with thermal energy only. Okay.
So, actually to add on, we can imagine like this, in this room, in your room, whichever room you are sitting. So, if there is an electrical heater at the center of the room, that is the energy generation term. Now, or otherwise, if someone is spraying water onto us, then that is the energy generation, in this case will be negative. So, energy generation doesn't mean always it is positive, the second part of your question. So, energy generation can be positive, energy generation can be negative. It depends on the process or it depends on the case by case. As I said, there are two examples. In one of the examples, electrical heater, energy generation is positive. If you are spray cooling, if it will be, energy generation will be negative because you are cooling. So energy generation can be either positive or negative depending on the situation.
So, any energy generation typically would involve conversion from one form to thermal energy. If it is conversion from chemical to mechanical energy, we are not concerned with that. We are concerned with transformation. We do not even care what is the source. We just want to know whether in a given problem there is going to be thermal energy coming in, generated, or thermal energy lost because of a process.
Very good question. This is only about thermal budgeting. This is only about thermal budgeting.
Yeah, not any other form. That is why it is called heat diffusion equation, not energy balance, general energy balance equation. Government College, Salem. Yes, please go ahead.
As you said, thermal conductivity is the property of material. Please elaborate the relation between thermal conductivity of material and its temperature.
Thermal conductivity varies with temperature. Now, whether it is going to vary linearly, non-linearly, whether it is going to increase, decrease, is all dependent on the molecular structure associated with the material. So, there is no general rule or general relationship for any unique answer for this question actually. So, for a given material, what is the variation, you can find out. Next, I think there is one more question quickly.
The variations of heat transfer rate with radius, it is both common for cylinder and sphere, sir.
Sorry, your audio is really bad. We are unable to hear anything. There is a lot of disturbance. Something related to 2.16. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
This figure is common for both cylinder and radius sphere, sir. Yes. Qualitatively,
this is not mathematical function, it is a qualitative representation. Okay. Nature of the curve is like that, increasing, decreasing curve with a maxima.
But the critical radius is going to be different for cylinder and sphere. For cylinder, it is going to be k by h, and for sphere, it is going to be 2k by h. But the nature of the curve, initial increase and later on decreasing and a maxima existing, is going to be same for both cylinder and sphere.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Shirpur College, over to you.
Sir, I have a small question. In the equation of critical radius of insulation, we got for the cylindrical system as k by RC is equal to k by H0. And during your explanation through graphs, you said that at this condition, the heat transfer rate will be maximum. So, how we can say that the heat transfer rate will be maximum? Will you please elaborate it through some mathematical expression? Over to you, sir.
For this, we will have to go back to what we had done before on the whiteboard. See, this, what will happen is, as I keep adding insulation, the surface area for convective heat transfer increases, and this causes the convective resistance to decrease. What is the convective resistance? R convection is 1 over H A. Okay, this is going to drop as R increases, that means as I add insulation. Conduction resistance is going to increase because you are adding more material, so greater the thickness, conduction resistance is going to increase as R increases. So, the summation of these two would give you a curve which looks qualitatively something like this, R total, and it comes to a minimum value somewhere, which we essentially is what we call as the critical radius of insulation. How did we get this? It is the summation of these two curves, and if you write Q is equal to delta T divided by R, R total, and in this case all resistances except these two are constant. If I say d by d outer radius, which is the variable of R conduction plus R convection is equal to 0, I come up with that so called critical radius of insulation, and that is this point. This point represents the point of minimum resistance and therefore a point of maximum heat transfer rate.
So for the application, we have to put the insulation much larger than this critical radius of insulation. So we cannot, we are not supposed to put the insulation thickness equal to critical radius. We have to put much larger. Our concern is, by chance, if we put our insulation much lower than the critical radius, that's the concern. In the next transparency, professor told us that typically for all applications, it is around 10 mm. So typically, any insulation, you will not put anything less than 10 mm. You will definitely put more than 10 mm. So most of the times, this care is taken care of. However, if one wants to do the calculations and show, we have to ensure that our critical radius of insulation is much, sorry, our insulation thickness is much larger than the critical radius of insulation. That is the concern.
Yeah, go ahead.
My question is the same again on critical radius of insulation. The graph you shown of Q max versus R critical. If the situation is of adiabatic type, then for which practical application, how will we vary Q with R?
Let us put that back.
For adiabatic situation, then for what critical radius of insulation we should?
Let me ask you back the question. How do you generate an adiabatic condition? The question asked by one of the participants is, how do I calculate or what is the usage of this critical radius of insulation under adiabatic situation? My question back to the participant is, how do you generate adiabatic condition? Professor, please tell me, how do you generate adiabatic condition in any heat transfer application? For example, heat exchanger. How do you generate an adiabatic condition?
No, sir. Adiabatic, it cannot be generated, but we can provide insulation. But I mean to say that how much by insulation we can go down for the heat transfer.
Okay.
And for so that, what should be the critical radius? That curve is going on decreasing. Up to what we can go?
Okay. See, the question now I understood. The question asked is, to generate adiabatic condition, what should be the radius of insulation? Okay. To answer this question, there is no way that you can make, you can get a purely adiabatic. There is going to be heat loss. No matter how much thickness we put, there is going to be heat loss. All that we are saying is that the temperature drop across the insulation is going to decrease with the thickness. But there is going to be heat loss. Heat loss is bound to be there. See, if we put a sweater, aren't we going to feel cold at all? It's like asking how much thick sweater I should wear so that I am not going to feel cold at all. No matter how thick sweater I use, I am going to feel the cold. But the temperature difference between the outer surface sweater temperature and my body temperature is going to decrease. There is going to be heat loss. It is quite difficult or almost impossible to generate adiabatic condition just by thickening the insulating material. Good evening. Please ask the question. We are able to hear you.
So my important question is, why suction lines are always insulated? And whether it is to be insulated below critical radius or above critical radius.
What lines?
Suction lines of compressors in case of refrigeration systems.
The question is, why do we insulate only the suction lines of refrigeration equipment? And if it is insulated on the suction side, whether that insulation should be above or below the critical radius? This is the question asked by one of the participants. So I don't think we should be insulating only the suction side. Why not on the pressure side? I think all the heat exchange equipment, whether it is condenser or evaporator.
Compressor. Compressor.
Yeah, on the compressor we will have, whether on the suction side or on the pressure side, whether it is evaporator or the condenser, both have to be insulated. And definitely whether it is condenser or in evaporator, the insulation thickness has to be more than the critical radius of insulation.
He's talking about, are you specifically asking about compressor?
Yes sir, I am specifically talking about the suction line joining from the evaporator to compressor. It is always insulated. I am interested to know why it is insulated and what is the criteria, because in case of refrigeration system it is always insulated. And condenser is never insulated in case of the refrigeration.
Okay, my take on that would be the following. See, evaporator typically operates at a lower temperature. Okay, compressor in inlet has to be as close as possible to a liquid state. Okay, because compressor power is directly proportional to the specific volume of the fluid. Right. So if there is a phase change and it becomes starts to become a vapor, then you are going to talk of a larger power consumption because you are going to handle gas. Okay. Yes, you are going to handle some amount of gas, but even the inlet, therefore, you do not want to increase the temperature as much as possible. Okay. That is probably the explanation I can think of at this moment. Yeah. Mufakam Ja College. Yeah.
So, my question is, you have spoken at length about the various forms of heat transfer. The conduction, radiation and convection. Now, I would like you to elaborate on heat transfer during orientation changes. For instance, in equinoxes, there is actually a tendency amongst people that there is an increase in radiation during equinoxes. So, what exactly is the reason? Is there an inclination of the rays or what exactly?
Equinox. Have I heard you right?
Exactly.
Okay. Second question?
Yeah, the second question is, you've given a very nice example, a very practical example of this various forms of heat transfer through a cup of coffee. So, give me a more practical sort of an example while explaining the relationship between viscosity and temperature.
Viscosity and temperature.
Viscosity, we can easily give an example. Viscosity usually increases with the increase of temperature in case of gases. And viscosity decreases with the increase of the temperature in case of liquids. This is general. And we also explain that through cohesion and adhesive forces, because in case of gases, what happens is that the intermolecular interaction or the collisions increasing with the increase of the temperature. So, the viscosity or the resistance increases in case of gases. On the other hand, in case of liquids, it decreases because the cohesive forces, the bond decreases because of the increase of the temperature. So, viscosity we can explain, but I do not know your first question.
I will take a shot at it.
The question is whether it is equinox or whatever be the situation.
No. Probably what I think happens in an equinox, I have forgotten the actual phenomena. I know that it is the day when the when the day and the night are equal to 12 hours each, but I think it is to do with the relative position of the sun with respect to the earth. So, I think that is the time when probably the from radiation point of view, the distance is either minimum, so that you are going to have a larger radiation component. It is the temperature of the sun is fixed, the temperature of the earth is also roughly the same at a given location. Probably it is the relative distance which is going to matter, and we cannot we have to fix the location. So, if you are at a particular place, probably what you are saying, if it is true, the only reason I can think of is the relative orientation of the two celestial bodies, that is the earth and the sun. I do not have a better explanation than this.
All right, thank you.
Erode.
I have two questions to ask. Question number one, what is the influence of thermal diffusivity and kinematic viscosity on heat transfer? When the heat transfer is taking place between the surrounding and spherical cell, you assume that there are some fluid inside the spherical tank. Okay, what are the influence of thermal diffusivity and kinematic viscosity of the fluid on heat transfer? Number one. Question number two. What are the factors which influence the overall heat transfer coefficient when the combination of convection and conduction is taking place?
We will take the second question. There are two questions. We will come back to first little later. I will rephrase question number two. His question was, what are the factors which influence the overall heat transfer coefficient, which involves conduction and convection? The factors that influence overall heat transfer coefficient U are essentially the factors which influence the convective heat transfer coefficient and the conduction heat resistance. Okay. So, from definition, we know UA is equal to reciprocal of the thermal resistances. So, it depends on the nature of the fluid, it depends on the nature of the flow, it depends on the type of geometry that you are dealing with. So, exactly the same parameters which influence H, the same parameters influence U, the same parameters which influence the resistance associated due to conduction, that is what is going to influence U. So, it is a combination of these two which is going to influence U. The first question, could you please elaborate again?
Okay. As far as the heat transfer through spherical shell, the ambient is air at room temperature. What are the influence of thermal diffusivity and kinematic viscosity, that is transport properties of fluid, on heat transfer? For example, if the more heat is transferred from the ambient to the inside the spherical shell, for example, liquid nitrogen is available, because of the, because the more heat transfer is there, because of the change in properties, transport properties, okay, then the evaporation rate will be higher, then there is a chance for explosion of liquid nitrogen. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, actually we have not, this is a question on influence of thermophysical properties, that is alpha and nu, on liquid nitrogen or spherical shell situation. We have not understood the question very well, but we will try to explain it with the problem that we have illustrated. Yeah. So,
see, if we have to see that whether the leakage or the leakage loss is more, all that we can say is that these resistances should be as less as possible. So, that means the heat loss can be high only when the resistances are less. So, I can see only when the resistances are less means the convective resistance can be made less only when the heat transfer coefficient is high. So, but then I cannot make inadvertently this heat transfer coefficient high. Yes, I think now perhaps I am understanding your question. What you perhaps mean is, yes, compared to natural convection, if I have a forced convection, let us say I put on a fan in front of my container, then my convective resistance decreases and then my heat transfer rate increases and the leakage loss rate will increase. So, essentially it is boiling down to the resistances. So, to answer, thermophysical properties, that is the nu coming in here, is only in terms of Reynolds number if it is a forced convection. So, other than that, I cannot see directly the kinematic viscosity effect coming in here and affecting the heat loss rate. If it is natural convection, yes, it is going to be Rayleigh number, which is G beta delta T divided by alpha nu. So, as the nu increases, my Rayleigh number decreases, the natural convection effect will decrease. So, essentially whether it is natural convection or forced convection, the thermophysical properties, that is the kinematic viscosity, is indeed having an effect, but ultimately this effect will be on H only. So, that is how I think we can understand this problem.
Right. I think you are correct.
There are some cases, practical cases, where the inside the spherical cell, some fluid is there, liquid is there, there may be a chance for a turbulence while traveling. Okay. So, if that turbulence comes into picture, then the Reynolds number is also increasing, no? In that case, what is the effect of thermophysical properties on heat transfer?
See, that the question asked is, what if there is a turbulence inside the container of this problem? Inside the container of this problem. Yes, professor had told that we have neglected the resistance because of the container, because inside the container
of the fluid.
Of the fluid. If there is turbulence inside, ultimately what will happen? There is no flow, it is a container. If there is a turbulence, then there can be some natural convection occurring inside. So, there is a resistance added on. If there is resistance added on, actually the heat loss rate should decrease. So, it's going to be a good situation if there is turbulence inside. The loss will definitely decrease. It's not going to make my life difficult. It's only going to aid my heat loss, in terms of heat loss.
Yeah, Nirma, please.
Yeah. How thermal conductivity varies with density of solids, liquids and gases?
See, thermal conductivity is directly related with the density only. See, why is, for example, if I ask myself a question, why is thermal conductivity of solid? I keep saying, I have been telling this since morning twice or thrice. Thermal conductivity of copper is 400. Thermal conductivity of water is 0.6. thermal conductivity of air is 0.02635 watt per meter Kelvin. So if you see here, solid is hundreds, liquid is points, one decimal, and gases is two decimals. So why is this? Answer is in your question itself. That is density. So the density of solids is very high. The density of solids is of the order of 8000. This density of liquid is of the order of 1000. That means density has decreased around 10 times. Now if I go to the density of air, it is almost 1000 times lesser. So that is how even the thermal conductivity is also decreasing. How closely my molecules are spaced so that the molecular diffusion or the molecular interaction is aided or abated decides my thermal conductivity. So thermal conductivity and density are directly related.
No, I am not comparing conductivity of metal, solids, liquids and gases. But in the same solid, suppose we are taking more dense material, then thermal conductivity would be different. So within the same medium itself, what is the effect of density?
Same answer is again same. If I have a denser material, thermal conductivity of denser solid material will have higher thermal conductivity as opposed to again solid whose density is lower. Let us take an insulating material. If you go on packing it densely, the thermal conductivity of the insulating material will be very less. But if I pack it loosely, then the porosity has increased, so thermal conductivity may not be very high. So basically, thermal conductivity of any material depends on how densely I pack it.
Okay, thank you.
Over to VJTI.
Yeah, my question is.
Yeah, go ahead.
How thermal conductivity varies with temperature?
Question is, how does the thermal conductivity of an alloy vary with temperature? Again, we cannot give an unique answer and say that thermal conductivity for all alloys is going to increase with temperature or decrease with temperature. It depends on the material. It depends on the material. But one question has been pending since morning is, why the thermal conductivity of an alloy is lower than the independent materials? That question we have kept it as pending. We will look at that question and come back. But there is no unique answer for this temperature variation of alloys. Back to you.
Particularly for non-ferrous alloys, how the thermal conductivity varies with temperature?
No, why only non-ferrous alloys? For any alloy, thermal conductivity is going to vary with temperature. It is going to be varying with temperature, but I have no idea about non-ferrous alloys separately or any other alloy for that matter. We have to look into it. We will come back on the Moodle forum or while during discussions in the morning tomorrow on this question.
Yeah.
Sir, my question is with the critical thickness of insulation. Is there any relation between economic thickness and critical thickness of insulation?
Okay. See, yeah, this is question is there any relation between economic thickness and critical radius of insulation? There is no unique answer, definitely yes. See, as we can see in the previous problem, let me answer this in a very generic fashion. First answer is that our insulation has to be definitely more than the critical radius of insulation so that my heat loss is less. But over and above that, how much I should be putting is a question, open-ended question. So it depends on how much I can spend and how much heat loss I can afford to have. Definitely, as I said in one of the previous questions, we cannot have zero heat loss. That is definitely not possible in any practical situation. We have to live with the heat loss, but only thing is that we can minimize the heat loss with the increase of the insulation thickness. But how much you can put, that is decided by economics. If you take a power plant, and even if you increase the thickness of the insulation by 1 mm, the heat exchangers are as big as one huge building. So if you increase the thickness by 1 mm, the cost may run into crores. So it is not always
space.
And also space. We need to have space to increase the insulation. So there is nothing like optimum economic thickness. It is all depends on how much money you have, how much space you have, how much you can afford to put. That's all. So there is nothing like optimal economic thickness. Only we have critical radius of insulation. All that we need to take care is that the real insulation we put has to be more than the critical radius of insulation.
Yeah, one more question, I think. Yeah.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question. Is thermal conductivity of a material related with the valency of the atom of that material?
Oh, yeah, actually they might be related because it is related to free electrons
which
they
are
might
there.
Be related so directly. If you ask me how directly they are related,
I think number of free electrons dictate the thermal conductivity vaguely. That's what I
correct.
Think. But so
number of free electrons. Sorry, the question asked is by one of the participants is the valency is related to the thermal conductivity. The answer is yes, I would think so. But why? Because the valency decides the number of the free electrons in any material. So, but how the valency and the number of the free electrons are related, I have no idea. We have to look into it. Okay.
Because I perhaps feel that the answer of dependence of thermal conductivity with the alloying element, I guess they are actually related. That's why I raised this question.
If you have any idea, please go ahead and answer that.
Okay, probably you are saying there is a decrease in the number of free electrons.
It was just a guess. I do not have
no,
it
no.
for sure.
We also don't have clearly because in regular UG books I am not getting that.
Probably true.
We will have. It might be true. It might
it,
be
it
true.
It might be true because
but we have to see that and
each parent material may have a certain number of free electrons, but when it is forming an alloy, it might be lost completely or it might be reduced so much that number of free electrons would be very less. Probably. Probably because we are not conversing.
We are not seen. We have to see it and then corroborate.
Yes, 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 sir. I also feel so.
We'll look in that direction.
We will
thank
definitely
you.
Look in that direction. It's a one clue for us.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Surat.
Yeah, sir. So far we have been talking about the thermal conductivity and its variation and independency on the temperatures and everything else. But my question is, the material which is tested upon the Earth's surface, which is at room, which is at one atmospheric pressure, if the same material is being kept in the space for which we are having very low pressure and temperature, and suppose at the same time we are having the Mach condition of greater than 1 or greater than 5, at that time we are having the atmosphere which will be generating the electromagnetic waves. So, do we considering that kind of thermal conductivity variation for the space application?
I'm sure they have.
We have to definitely take care of. There will be influence of pressure. See, the question asked by one of the participants is the thermal conductivity going to be different if I measure in Earth and in space, because the pressures
where
in space and Earth are different, and also in space I am moving at a high Mach number. That is the question asked. Definitely the thermal conductivity will be different dependent on pressure, but how much, it depends on the amount of the pressure what we operate. But there is no closed form answer again for this question. But all that I can say is that the thermal conductivity, like it is dependent on temperature, it is also dependent on pressure, but it's not maybe as strong function as temperature.
And any testing which is done has to be done at situations where it is going to be put in use. So, for space situation applications, if you have done calculations and obtained some value of thermal conductivity which is at room temperature, definitely it is not going to be valid. I think your question is coming from Columbia accident, where that there was a peel off because of the brick had to be peeled, fell off because it was unable to withstand the heat. Probably from that you are coming. Definitely you will have to take care of the operating conditions, which would be high speed, pressure, and all these also will translate to heat directly. High speed will translate to heat, I think, directly. So, you will have to test it in those conditions in the lab, simulate those conditions.
In fact, that is what happened even in the failure of Challenger shuttle. In the Challenger shuttle, when Dr. Feynman looked at what was the reason for the failure of the Challenger shuttle,
the gasket in the rockets which was being used was tested under ambient conditions, but actually it was supposed to be used in cryogenic rockets which are operating at cryogenic temperatures and pressures different. So definitely the conditions under which they are being used and under which they are being tested have to be same.
Similar.
Back to Hemant.
So my specific question is there any body forces effect on the solid material conductivity?
The last question you asked was, is there any influence of the electromagnetic force on the thermal conductivity?
Body force.
Body force. That is the body force. Electromagnetic force, he told.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Electromagnetic force.
Yeah, so that can be considered body force.
Yeah. Can be considered as
a body force.
So the question is whether electromagnetic force, which is a body force, is having an influence on the thermal conductivity. On the face of it, I cannot imagine any effect of the electromagnetic force on the thermal conductivity, but honestly I don't know the answer.
If it causes a realignment of the molecules, then yes, I don't know.
It is a hand waving answer again. So that is what professor is saying, is that if
structural realignment,
molecular structure is going to change because of the application of the electromagnetic forces on my
solid,
then only my thermal conductivity is going to change. If my molecular structure is not going to change, why should my thermal conductivity change? But then this is a vague answer. We have no answer for this. We have to look into it specifically. Hemant, why don't you come back with some answer?
Yeah, definitely, sir. I get back to you, sir, with the answer.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I think we are...
Okay, that's for the day.